Okay. So usually I always come at King David a lot. I don't come at him, but I use him as an example of why polygamy or is not, you know, what Elohim intended, and how he went into Uriah's wife, and got her pregnant. And so what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at scriptures, Psalms 51, a psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet came unto him after he had gone into Bathsheba. Okay, and we know that I always use the example of him getting Uriah killed after that. But this is how King David, or HaMelech David, asked and begged Elohim and besought him for forgiveness. And this is an example of what we should do. Although we should always look to Yeshua, the Mashiach, as he is a great example. We should always read scriptures in context, and we need the Old and New Testament to understand it. And we especially need the Holy Ruach, or the Holy Spirit of the Creator, to understand scriptures.
Shalom, Ms. Kapha. Now, this is not an attack on the sister, the beautiful sister. She just needs to be humble and stop teaching that Yiddish. Be careful, sis. You might end up one of my wives. Nevertheless, man, let's first address what she stated about the Most High being against polygamy. In fact, not only was he not against it, he gave David Saul's wives as a gift. So how can he be against it if he did that himself? Secondly, the second thing I'm going to address is that he built his nation, the nation of Yasha Allah, the nation of Israel, with Jacob, who had four wives. Let's get those two precepts. First, 2 Samuel 12, verse 8. And I gave thee thy master's house and their master's wives into thy bosom, and gave thee the house of Israel and Judah. And if that had been too little, I would have moreover have given unto thee such and such things. So the Most High gave these things to David as a gift to include Saul's wives. It is just idiotic to suggest that he's against polygamy. And so if he's the father of all creation, if he's the Abba, if he's the omnipotent, it doesn't matter what you read somewhere else. It states right here that he gave these things to David, right? See, the next thing I want to address is that he built his nation off of a man that had four wives. You women need to get out of your emotions and start reading scriptures and stop tap dancing around the truth. Leah and Rachel are sisters, wife, right? They were sisters. They were both Jacob's wives. This was before the Levitical law was actually passed on incest, right? Because the Most High wanted to build his nation with somewhat of a pure family. So he used these two sisters. Thereafter, incest became sinful. So let's get it. You could read Bereshit, Genesis 30, verse 3. And then the two women became Jacob's wives after he marries their mistress, their handmaids. And when we read that in Bereshit 29 and 27, you can read that for yourselves. I'm not going to read it because I don't want to take too much time on this video. Now let's address the other issue that she was alleging, why polygamy is illegal. No, David's personal sin has nothing to do with polygamy. It doesn't mean that the Most High forbid it. See, David sinned, and that's why he was asking for forgiveness of his sin. Why? Because he lusted for Beersheba when he saw her naked, right? She tempted him, right? She tempted him. She was bathing, you know, and she knew he was watching her. And so he decided to put her husband in front of the battle so that he would be actually murdered. So, and the Most High cursed David for that, right? He didn't say polygamy. See, when the Most High doesn't want you to do something, he said, thou shall not. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not steal. And David violated one of the Ten Commandments because he violated that man's property. See, your wife, brothers, is your property. You're the prize. And feminists won't like this. You're the prize. And she is your gift. She was created for the man. So you can read about what transpired between David and Bereshit in 2 Samuel 11 and 27, right? So what's the lessons that we take away from this? From this story, we could learn several takeaways, right? First, it is easier to be led to sin if we are idle, like David. He was idle. Remember, after Adam's first fall, because he hearkened to the voice of his wife, the Most High cursed the ground for our sake. Remember, he didn't curse the man. He cursed the ground for our sake, but he cursed the woman. He cursed the Isha. She would be, you know what I mean, going through pain, through childbirth, and so on and so forth. And so because of this, because of this toil and labor, we won't be idle. So when you're idle, when you're sitting around, men sit around, they start watching porn, their minds are idle. So the Most High wants you to stay busy. You can read about that in Bereshit, Genesis 3 and 17. Now, the first sin that occurred with David, is he coveted Bathsheba. That's going against the Ten Commandments, right? That Moshe brought to us. See, when he saw her bathing, he didn't turn away. Book of James 1 and 15 say, then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. When he started lusting for her and he didn't turn away, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, it bringeth forth death. Death is separation from the Most High. That's the first form of death. You die spiritually, and all in Adam die. But he saw her, he saw that she was beautiful, then he coveted her. The 10th commandment states, thou shalt not covet anything that is thy neighbor's. Exodus, Shemot 20 verse 17. So David then acted upon that lust, and he found out that she was married, and he chose to commit adultery. It's not that polygamy is illegal. The Most High gave David Saul's wives, but David lusted for this woman, and it causes him to commit adultery. He committed adultery with her, and the 7th commandment states clearly, you shall not commit adultery. Shemot 20 verse 14, Exodus 20 and 14. So after coveting, which actually led to adultery, David murdered her husband when he violated then the 6th commandment. So look, he done violated 3 of the 10 commandments already. How did he violate the 6th commandment? Because the 6th commandment clearly states, you shall not murder. Shemot 20 and 13. So it's easy to see from this story of, you know, David, how one can actually, one sin could literally lead to another greater sin and another sin and another sin. See, this desire leads to sin. And then the sin grows and it brings death. James 1 and 15. Therefore, when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, it bringeth forth death. And so after David's sin with Bathsheba, Yahuwah did not have to cut the marital relationship with her since her husband was dead. She was released from that. Remember Romans 7 and 2, 1 Corinthians 7 and 39? She can accept another husband if her husband's dead. David knew the law. He knew this. That's why he had a husband murdered. It's clear, Romans 7 and 2, through 3, for the woman who has a husband is bound by the law to her husband as long as he lived. David knew this law. So he had her husband murdered. Right? So if then, while her husband lives, she marries another man, she will be called an adulteress. But if her husband dies, she is free from that law. So that she's no adulteress, though she has married another man. But David got a punishment. It doesn't make polygamy illegal, my beautiful sister, Moshe. So the Supreme Elohim punished David and brought upon him the evil consequences of his sins to teach us the pure character of Yahuwah. But for women to keep trying to say polygamy is illegal, if you get out of your emotions, this message will touch you, because a real priest, real Kahan, got the Bible now, man. And I teach the truth. You stop tap dancing around the truth. Get out of your emotions. So there's 3 direct consequences that was inflicted upon David, right? First, Nathan said, the sword would never depart from David's house, when we read 2 Samuel 12 and 10. And this was fulfilled in the successive violent deaths of at least 3 of his sons. Ammon, 2 Samuel 13 and 29. Absalom, 2 Samuel 18, verse 14. and Tazadaq in 1 Kings 2 and 25. So David was punished for his sins. The Most High took three of his sons. Understand that. The second thing that transpired is Nathan also prophesied that David, that his own wives would be humiliated before all Israel. When we read the book of 2 Samuel 12 and 11. And this was fulfilled when Absalom laid with his father's concubines in the sight of all Israel. 2 Samuel 16 and 22. And the third way that David was punished is that Nathan prophesied that the fatal end of his son conceived by David's sin would bear a Sheva. 2 Samuel 12 and 14. And this was fulfilled 7 days after Nathan's judgment sentence, when we read the book of 2 Samuel 12 and 18. So to David, the death of his son was a far greater punishment than his own death. So then she went into Tehillim and talking about David's repentance. Right, Psalms 51. That was the repentance and conversion. So as a result of all of this bitter experience, he passed through King David. Malik David was brought to complete repentance and conversion. And this was Yahuwah's goal. See, we read about this change in the book of Tehillim, Psalms 51. This was written at the time where David not only confessed his sins and prayed for forgiveness, but also asked the Supreme Elohim, Yahuwah, to create a clean heart and renew a right spirit within him. He prayed, blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from sin. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Psalms 51 and 2, 3, 7, and 10. So Yahuwah, the Supreme Elohim, in his mercy allows men to see the results of their sin and are not increasing prosperity and happiness, but in misery. That's what sin leads to. Woe. Death. See, his protection, his protecting hand was withdrawn from David, right? And the king was permitted to taste the bitter fruits of his sin. And David realized that the pathway to true happiness could not be found in disobedience to the Supreme Elohim. You understand? The story of David and Bathsheba is recorded in the Bible for us to learn from, not to try and say the Most High was against polygamy. You do error not knowing the scriptures nor the power of the Most High. You need a strong man like me to teach you the truth. KAHANTAZADAQ, you know who said it. I pray that more sisters could receive this message. This is to prevent people from teaching you lies. See, when the truth comes, all false things must disappear. I speak the truth. Yakanon 8 and 32. And you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. I put a spin on that and say, you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you mad. And if you ever get over your anger, then you will be free. I'm KAHANTAZADAQ, and this is the truth according to how it is written. We teach the Bible according to Isaiah 48 and 10. Precept upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line. Hear a little, dear little. Thank you for listening. I'm going to say Shalom. Kwam Yashallah. May the Most High and Hamashiach keep you. Like, share, subscribe. Shalom.
Join our assembly. Email tazadaqshah@yahoo.com. tazadaqshah@yahoo.com. Tune into our Tuesday night Bible studies and Friday night Bible studies at 8:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Shalom.
everything. Even gave us a slave on his name. Left black, return white, it's a game.
Dirty game.
That was stated by Kamal Hussein.
For our great four, we existed prior to all of you all.
Exercise.
We inscribed our history on ancient walls. But you claim our names in your great hall of fames and gave us slave names like Smith, White, Jones, or Duval. We were intellectual giants, but that man's plan made our goals too small. But I embraced the Torah and got a total recall. Illuminous figures went to swastika a nigga. But the black Holocaust was far worse than Hitler's. You're mayor of the city because Esau made you bigger, but
to them,
you're still just a bigger.
Let's go.